Penguin Random House Audio presents The Class, a life-changing teacher, his world-changing kids, and the most inventive classroom in America. This is the author, Heather Juan Tesoriero. For K, G, and E, who taught my heart everything it ever needed to know, and in loving memory of my brother, Matthew Robert Tesoriero, 1983 to 1991. I cannot teach anybody anything. I can only make them think. Socrates. It's not the broken dreams that break us. It's the ones we don't dare to dream. Mr. Shu, on Glee. Author's note. I spent the entire 2016-2017 school year with Andy Bramante and his science research students. I commuted daily to Greenwich High School, minus occasional days off to write, and traveled to Washington, D.C., Los Angeles, and multiple locations in Connecticut to report on the science competitions. I recorded more than 70 hours of interviews, conversations, and presentations. I also kept digital and analog notes from my time with Andy and his kids. It was impossible to be present for every scene in the book, so some have been reconstructed following extensive interviews. There are several instances where names have been changed. In each case, I've explicitly stated when I've done so. Summer. Chapter 1. Andy. On July 18th, 2016, at 2:22 a.m., Andy Bramante's cell phone buzzed with an incoming text. He rolled over in his bed, pulled his phone close to his face, and saw a message from Shobita Sundaram. "Hey, guess who's a regional finalist for Google Science Fair?" read the little text bubble. Squinting down at his phone, Andy tapped out a reply. "Yay, so happy for ya." Shobi had spent her sophomore year in Andy's science research class at Greenwich High School, building an algorithm that could help predict which breast cancer drugs would be most effective in killing tumors. She taught herself to code in middle school and was also a masterful public speaker, a crucial weapon in the science fair world. Between the knockout algorithm and her impressive ability to tout it, Andy thought Shobita, a.k.a. Shobi, the Shobinator, and Shobi-Wan Kenobi, was poised to floor the judges at the Connecticut Science and Engineering Fair, CSEF, the gateway to Intel International Science and Engineering Fair, ISEF, the mother of all science fairs. So it had seemed a shocking oversight of sorts when she failed to place at CSEF back in March. It had also infuriated Shobi's mother, who'd wanted to send a scathing email to the judges. Now, as he read the text that Shobi was a regional finalist for the Google Science Fair, where thousands of kids from all over the world submitted a slew of ambitious projects, everything from fighting drought with fruit to detecting lung cancer with a breath test, a sense of redemption washed over Andy. He was thrilled that Shobi got her due. He fell back to sleep, but less than an hour later, his phone buzzed again. The 3:10 a.m. message was from William Yin, a rising senior and one of the most astounding kids Andy had ever had in his class. "Hi, Mr. B," read the first text bubble. The second said, "Shobi and I are GSF regional finalists." "Ah, William." This was not so much a big surprise to Andy as continued validation for William's invention. He developed a blueprint for a Band-Aid-like sticker that could be applied to the neck to detect the presence of atherosclerosis, the plaque that can break off, form a clot, and kill you with a heart attack or stroke. The Google accolade was the latest glittery float in a seemingly endless parade of William's victories for his sticker. Andy tapped out a congratulatory reply that involved a lot of exclamation points, trying to make his delight register through his foggy haze. William would always be one of Andy's most beloved, if crazy-making, students. There was a deep connection between the two, one born of brutally long days in the lab and the process of trying to work through the enigma that was William. But now Andy just wanted to get some shut-eye. He set his phone down on his night table, rolled over, and went back to sleep. When he finally woke up for good that day, Andy texted back and forth to get some more reaction from the kids about the news. Shobi was especially giddy. The night before, she'd set her alarm to wake up at 2 a.m. Eastern time when Google released the names. Shobi figured if she wasn't among this first cut of winners, she could just return to bed and sleep off her disappointment, rather than get up at a normal hour, learn she hadn't advanced, and spend her whole day being dogged by it. Bleary-eyed, she woke up from her phone's alarm, opened her laptop, and logged onto the Google Science Fair site. And there on the page announcing the 100 regional finalists were her photo and project, her region being the Americas. The 16 global finalists would be named in August. Shobi texted Andy that her parents were, quote, so happy, and I was too, once my heart rate had gone back to normal. I swear I got a heart attack when I saw my face on the page. For the second year in a row, there was just one school and one teacher in the world with two Google regional finalists, Greenwich High and Andy Bramante. Andy's science research class is unlike any other class at Greenwich High, a Connecticut public school behemoth with 2,650 kids. There is no curriculum, no tests, textbooks, or lectures. Students pitch individual projects that they work on throughout the entire school year with the goal of taking their discoveries and inventions out on the national and global science fair circuit. This is not the stuff of vinegar volcanoes and ant farms. Kids tackle problems like cancer, Parkinson's disease, HIV, heart disease, cheap water filtration, and carbon dioxide capture, sometimes making discoveries that elude adult scientists three times their age. Andy Bramante arrived at GHS in 2005 as a chemistry teacher and picked up the research program the following year. In the years since, he's turned the program into a juggernaut, amassing one of the most impressive track records in America when it comes to kids competing in the science fair world. Year after year, his kids dominate the fair circuit and take home prizes in unprecedented numbers, all of which is particularly impressive because Andy is far from a career educator. He walked away from a successful run as a scientist in corporate America to teach high school. The stakes of everything that happens in Andy's science research class seem to rise exponentially here in Greenwich, population 62,000, a beautiful seaside town that borders New York State and offers sweeping views of the Long Island Sound. It's a town beset with competition, even beyond the usual suburban jostling for bigger houses, better cars, and sterling children. But beneath the readily apparent affluence, Greenwich is a multifaceted place, and a lot more diverse than you might think. At Greenwich High School, 21% of the student body is Hispanic, 9% is Asian, and 4% is African American. Greenwich also has considerable populations of immigrants and expatriates. GHS is home to kids from 61 countries. 20% speak a language other than English at home. Andy's class fully embodies this diversity and spans the poles of Greenwich privilege. He's had a student whose family spent thousands of dollars to outfit a custom lab in their basement, as well as a kid to whom he offered a sweater, thinking he could use what for Andy was a holiday cast-off. He regularly has students from families for whom money is so abundant, it's an afterthought. By contrast, he teaches kids who live so far outside the money bubble, their families rent modest condos because purchasing a home in this town, the median home price is $1 million, is nowhere within reach. One year, a kid asked for an extension to pay the initial $150 project fee because he was covering it from his after-school job earnings. And when it's become apparent that a kid's family can't pay for some of the extras, Andy finds a way to pick up the costs without ever mentioning it to the student. The common thread among all these families, the multi-generational Greenwich establishment, as well as the new immigrants who live, figuratively and literally, far from the country clubs, rowing clubs, polo grounds, and lush estates, is that they want their children to get a superior education and have chosen Greenwich for this reason. But in so doing, they've entered into a uniquely competitive culture of achievement, one that plays out in Andy's class. The science fairs hold a powerful draw for Andy's students. For starters, There's prestige attached to even getting accepted to compete in a fair, where kids display sleek posters and give daunting oral presentations about their work. They stand in crowded, buzzing auditoriums, dressed up like mini adults, jackets and ties for boys, pumps and skirts or dresses for girls, fielding a barrage of questions from judges, as if defending a dissertation. The entire experience brute forces them into a solo public performance where they expound on the intricacies of their projects, every word their own, propelled forward.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.